Well, I've already told you what we're looking at this evening, so let me begin by reading Ephesians chapter 5. I'd like to read verses 1 through 21 of Ephesians 5, but what we're going to do is focus on just a couple of verses here, very familiar verses, verses that we often look at the beginning of a new year, as we consider another year has rolled by, and again, there's only so many years that are going to roll by, until we're no longer on this earth, time like an ever-rolling stream bears all its sons away. But thankfully, if we're trusting in the Lord, it's going to bear us to a much better place. However, what we want to focus on this evening is how to use the time that we have while we're here for the Lord's glory, because it isn't all just about us. It's about Him. So this is what Paul writes in Ephesians 5, beginning in verse 1. He says, "Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. But immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. And there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead even expose them, for it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light, for everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason it says, 'Awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.' Therefore be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. So then do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father, and be subject to one another in the fear of Christ." May the Lord bless again His word to our understanding this evening. Now, I've already mentioned this morning, we were reminded, again just reminded, because we already know this, but we often forget. Again, the busyness of life, all the cares and concerns of life can draw us away from what is most important. Jesus called us to strive, to do our best, not just to seek the kingdom, but to do our best to seek the kingdom, to strive to enter the kingdom. Now, again, we were reminded this morning that if we've trusted Jesus, we have already entered into His kingdom. Of course, through Jesus, He is the door, He is the only way. But having entered, having trusted Jesus by the grace that He gives to us by His Holy Spirit, we are reminded that His Spirit is going to do a work within us. He is going to move us, motivate us, cause us to do our best to become like Jesus and to move His kingdom forward. The idea of striving to enter the narrow door has to do, of course, with trusting Jesus to be saved, but it also has to do with continuing to move forward. That's what all these other analogies that I've already made reference to have to do with: the competition, the running the race, the buffeting ourselves, the disciplining of ourselves. We need to press on towards perfection. Now, what we saw was that Jesus has done all to save us. He is the one who does all in us by His Holy Spirit. But the result of that work is that we do all. The evidence of His work within our lives is the fact that we are now actually doing what it is He calls us to do. We are seeking first His kingdom, and we're doing it to the very best of our ability. Now, this evening, what I want us to do is consider the same subject, perhaps from a different angle, perhaps from a more practical angle, and that is how we are to use our time. I mean, time is that in which we have to do what it is the Lord calls us to do, and using it wisely is what we're talking about here. Using it to advance the kingdom, using it to pursue the kingdom, and really putting all else aside. Paul reminds us, with regard to time, in the passage we've just read, that we've already wasted enough of it. We wasted it while we were in the world, when we were living like the rest of the world. But now that we have been called into God's kingdom, we need to live differently. Not unwisely, as we had been living, but now wisely. We need to redeem the time that we have remaining for God's glory, which I've said is essentially the same thing as striving to advance His kingdom. Now, since time is so short and how we use it is so important to us and to the kingdom, let's be encouraged this evening to make the most of our time. Now, first of all, let's just simply consider what we mean by time. What is time? Now, time, as we think about what it is in its essence, is really something that can be difficult to define, so we're not even going to attempt to do that because we really don't even know what it is for sure. But we do know some things about it. We know that God created it. We know that God Himself has always existed, that He has existed outside of time in what's called the eternal now, or basically in eternity, and that time didn't actually come into being until He spoke at the very beginning and set it in motion. Basically, creatures need time in which to exist. God does not. We know God created it, but we also know that time is something that is always moving. If you just look at the hands of the clock on the wall back there, or perhaps if you have a wristwatch that has hands on it, you know that those hands were actually made to measure time. One thing that is true about the hands on the clock or on your wristwatch is that they are never still, but they are always in motion, because time is always in motion. One thing else we know about time is that time is always moving in only one direction. It's going forward, and it never goes backward. Again, we see that when we look at a clock, the hands are always going in the same direction. They do not back up unless, of course, you force them to, but that doesn't change what happens to the actual time. We know that once time is passed, once these moments that make up time are gone, they can never be relived. We cannot go back to the past and do things differently. And we know that time is never going to come to an end. Now, I realize that there are some who believe the Scriptures teach that time is going to stop and we're going to enter into eternity, but that isn't actually what happens. We are bound by time. We can only exist in time. We cannot exist really in eternity. But the thing about God is He exists outside of time and He exists within time. And so we will be with the Lord forever, but He will be basically where we are, as it were, in time, that He will continue that environment. So because what God has made can only exist in time, and since He has determined by His divine plan that what He has made will never cease to exist, time is never going to cease to exist. So again, we don't know what time is, but we do know certain things about time. Again, there's only so, well, it goes on forever, always moving forward. Now let's consider, secondly, how much time we have, because I think that's a very important question. Now, in one sense, we have unlimited time. The Lord tells us that, again, time is never going to end. We are never going to cease to exist. And so we are going to live forever. Actually, whether we trust Jesus or not, but now I'm thinking particularly those of us who have trusted the Lord Jesus. And that means that the opportunities that we have to worship and serve the Lord are never going to end, because the Lord is never going to let them end. So we worship the Lord in this life, and when we go into heaven, we get to continue to worship Him, we get to continue to serve Him. We will always have that opportunity, which is a tremendous blessing for us. But I think we understand that what is a blessing to us can be a curse to others, because not everybody is going to be in heaven. I think one thing that atheists fear more than just about anything else is that their existence, at least in their understanding, is going to come to an end. That when their lives are over, they're going to enter into nothingness, that they're no longer going to be aware of themselves or of anything else, and that the idea of nothingness scares them. Now, sadly, it's going to be much worse than they imagine. When they leave this world, they will only wish that that really was the case, but it isn't. Remember what Jesus said of Judas, one who was unconverted, and so in the same condition as everyone who dies without Christ. Jesus says in Matthew 26, verse 24, it would have been good for that man if he had not been born. That is, if he had never come into existence, actually in the first place. Now, there's really no difference between never having existed and having existed no longer to exist, because in both cases you don't exist. But Jesus tells us that there is a difference, because existence doesn't end. What he meant was it would be better not to have existed than to exist for eternity in hell, which is where Judas was heading. Now, we do need to understand that this is what's going to happen to everyone who doesn't hear the gospel, to everyone who doesn't trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. They are going to have to pay for their sins, and the Lord is going to hold them accountable for every single one of them. Time is never going to come to an end for them either. It doesn't end for anyone. The question is, in what condition are we going to exist? If we trust in Jesus, again, let's remember, endless time is a blessing, because we get to spend endless time with the Lord who loved us and gave His Son for us. So in one sense, time for us is unlimited. The opportunities to worship and serve the Lord are never going to come to an end. But as you well know, there is another sense, excuse me, in which our time is limited. Though it will never end ultimately, it will end in this world. We only have so much time here, and so only so much opportunity to use it wisely by using it for Jesus. Well, let's consider then the preciousness of this time that we actually have in this world. Just how precious is it? Well, it's very precious, which is why Paul counsels us to make the best use of what we have. Now, just how valuable is time? I think a common valuator or standard of anything, at least of the things in this world. How do you determine the value of something in this world? Well, it's usually determined by two things, supply and demand. And I think we can apply that to the time we have in this world. Let me give you a couple of examples. Dust is in great supply, but it's in very little demand. And so therefore it has no value. As a matter of fact, it's more of a nuisance than anything else. I don't think any of us value dust. Gold, on the other hand, is in short supply, but there's a great demand for it because it's beautiful, because it's useful. And so it has a very high value. We know that time can actually decrease the value of certain things, but it can also increase the value of certain other things, and again, because of supply and demand. Time can decrease the value of cars because, you know, as cars get older, they're less in demand, or sometimes houses, and again, to a certain degree, because if a car gets really old and becomes an antique, then it becomes valuable again, and the same thing is true of houses, and we'll look at that in the second example. Time can decrease the value of certain things. I mean, we usually don't think that buying a really old car is a good thing because it's going to have a lot of problems. But time can also increase the value of things. And the reason why it does is because time reduces the supply and tends to increase the demand. A piece of pottery, which was made 3,500 years ago in Egypt, may have sold for a little bit of money. It may not have had that much value. But that same piece of pottery is worth much more today because there are much fewer of them, and the demand for them, therefore, has gone up. I thought a more modern example, one that just, to me, is kind of remarkable, is when the first issue of Action Comics that introduced the world to Superman, okay, was published and came out in June of 1938. Do you realize that a mint copy of number one Action Comics sold for 10 cents. But now, nearly 80 years later, the supply has gone down. They estimate there was around 200,000 to 250,000 copies of this comic printed. Today, they're only aware of about 100 that exist. And the quality of the comics have gone down as well. There are only two that are considered in near mint condition. Since the supply of good copies has gone way down, it has driven the demand for those particular copies way up. Now, the last time one of those two copies sold, it sold for $3.2 million. Boy, if you lived in 1938, that would have been a great investment, wouldn't it? But again, supply and demand. There's less a supply of those that are good. The demand goes up because it has value in somebody's eyes and they want it and they're willing to pay for it. Well, what about time? How precious is time? Well, first of all, what about the supply? How much of a supply of time do we actually have? How much is there? Well, there's one unknown because we really have no way of knowing how much time each of us has in the world. Now, we've already read in Psalm 90 what Moses has to say about life in general, how long life is. He says in Psalm 90, verse 10, "As for the days of our life, they contain 70 years, or if due to strength, 80 years. Yet their pride is but labor and sorrow, for soon it is gone, and we fly away." How much time do we have? 70 years? 80 years? We may have more. We may have less. If we had lived a century ago, if we had lived two centuries ago, we would likely have much less. You know, it wasn't that long ago, the average life expectancy, if you survived infancy, and only 50% of the children actually survived, I'm thinking about the colonial days, you could expect to live into your early 30s. And that was pretty much it. Now, there were people who lived into their 80s, but that was rare. Most people died in their 30s. Today, the life expectancy is around 80 years. Now, is 70 or 80 years very long? Is that a long amount of time? Is that a great supply? Well, it has to do with one's perspective, I think. If you asked a child, is 80 years a long time? They would say, yeah, 80 years, that's an eternity. But ask somebody who is elderly, and they'll tell you it's very short. Now, does it really boil down to a matter of one's own perspective? Not really, because the Bible tells us that it is short. Soon it is gone, and we fly away. James writes in James 4:14, "You and me, we're just a vapor that appears for a little while and then vanishes away." And then Job in Job 14, verses 1 and 2. "Man who is born of woman is short-lived and full of turmoil. Like a flower, he comes forth and withers. He also flees like a shadow. and does not remain. And he said that in a day when the life expectancy was higher. Now what this means is that as far as supply is concerned, or as far as the supply of time is concerned, it is limited. What about the demand for time? Well, those who are young, who think that they have endless eons basically stretching out in front of them from there until 80 years of age, they don't really place much value on time. And just again, think about your own experience. When you were younger, you didn't really think that much of time because you thought there was a lot of it. And so you found it very easy to waste time. But those of us who are older, and especially I would venture to say those who are on their deathbed, value it much more because there is so little left. For them, the demand becomes greater, and so it becomes more valuable to them. So the supply is limited, and the demand is great, and that means that time is precious. Time is very precious, especially when you consider that once you've used all that you have, there is absolutely nothing you can do to get any more. As Jonathan Edwards once said, all the money in the world, all the wealth of the universe could never even buy back one moment of time. That's why time is so precious. Now, since time is precious, what we do with time is very important. What should we do with it? Paul tells us that we should make the most of it, especially when we consider that time represents the opportunities that we have to serve the Lord in this world. It is the medium in which we exist for this time in this place. He writes in Ephesians 5, verses 15 and 16, or actually I think this is just one of those two verses, "Therefore be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil." That was both verses. We need to use it wisely. So how can we do that? How can we make the most of it? Well, first of all, I think the most obvious thing is we need to stop wasting time. There's nothing we can do about the time we have already wasted, the time that's already passed. As we said, time only moves in one direction. We can't go back and change the past. All we can do is use the time that we have remaining. We also need to make sure that we don't waste time lamenting the time that we've already wasted. I mean, some people, and this is something, again, that Jonathan Edwards points out, that this is what the devil does. As a matter of fact, with regard to time, the devil's at work, our flesh is at work, the world is at work, trying to work against us. What he said is, when you're young, the devil will come to you and say, you've got all this time in front of you. So don't worry about coming to Christ. Don't worry about serving Christ. Just take it easy and have fun. And then as you move along in life, and now most of your life is behind you, the devil will then say to you, you've already wasted most of your life. So, you know, there's really nothing more you can do. You've been a fool. You're not going to use the time in the future any better. So he'll try to get them to spend the rest of their time lamenting the time that's been wasted. The devil will always work against us to try to get us to waste more time because he doesn't want us to do what we need to be doing. What we need to do is learn from the wasted time, not to waste anymore, and begin using what we have left, begin valuing what we have remaining, and use it as wisely as we can. So how can we use our remaining time more wisely? Well, I'm just going to give us perhaps a principle here, and what I want us to do is basically to adopt a certain perspective. Now, one of the reasons why those who lived back in the days of the colonies were able to do so much with their lives, not everyone, but those that did, why they were able to do so much, if you read, for instance, the works of Murray McShane, and see how much he did, realizing he died, I think, in his 20s. He was just a very young man. But yet, he did. It seems like he lived a lifetime in those few years. How was he able to do it? Why did he do it? Well, one of the reasons was, as I already mentioned before, was because for them, time was in much shorter supply. when they were born, as they grew up, I mean, they went to college very early at somewhere around 13, 14 years of age. And then when they graduated, they figured that they had until their early 30s, and then they were going to be gone. So if they were going to do anything useful in the world at all, they had to do it right away, or their life would be wasted. So they had a different kind of motivation. Time is in short supply, therefore I need to use it as wisely as I can. Now today, with life expectancy approaching 80, we don't feel like, you know, perhaps, especially when we're younger, that we need to be in much of a hurry. We have a different perspective than they had. Now, perspective has a lot to do with how we view things. It is, as a matter of fact, how we view things, as we've already seen. So it would be good for us to have the right perspective that will help us better see how to use time, whether we're using it well or using it badly. And I think the only perspective that I can think of, or perhaps the best, that will help us do this, is the one that we will have on the day when we stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, on the day of His judgment, because on that day we will see things as they really are. Now, again, let me just, have you ever been in a situation where you thought you were going to die? Okay? Did that change your perspective? It does, because suddenly time seems so short, and you begin to take a good look at your life, and you begin to lament the things that you were doing that were wasted, and lament the fact that you weren't using your time more wisely. Well, if it's like that when you're faced with death, what's it going to be like when you stand before the Lord? Because on that day, the Lord tells us, Jesus, He's going to look over what it is we've done. Now, what do we want Jesus to see when He looks at our works? Now, one thing we certainly don't want Him to see are our sins. And thankfully, He's not going to see them, because Jude writes in verses 24 and 25, "Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of His glory blameless with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever." Notice He says that He is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of His glory blameless with great joy. If you had to stand before the Lord and all your sins were going to be paraded, that wouldn't give you a great deal of joy, nor would it count you blameless. But that's exactly how you will appear before the Lord on that day if you have trusted Jesus. And again, if you haven't, we've already talked about what will happen then. All your sins clinging to you, it's going to be too late to do anything about it then. So you need to make sure you take care of that now by trusting in Jesus. Now, our sins are not going to appear as sin, but they will, in some respects, be there, because they will appear as lost time, as lost opportunities, as having nothing to show for them. They'll just basically be black holes, lost time. We'll have nothing to show for them, and we'll have less to show overall. So if you want to use time wisely, then make sure you stop throwing time away, pouring it down the hole, as it were, to sin, giving it away to the things which you know are dishonoring to the Lord. Now, there's a myriad of other reasons why we shouldn't sin, but here's one in that regard. You want to use your time wisely? Don't give it to the enemy. Don't give in to your flesh. Yield to the Spirit, not to the flesh. So what will Jesus see on that day? Well, He's going to see everything else we've done, right? Some of the things will have some value, and some of the things we've done won't have any value. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 3, verses 11 through 15, "For no man can lay a foundation other than the one which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if any man builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it, because it is to be revealed with fire. And the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. If any man's work which he has built on it remains, he will receive a reward. If any man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Now, I do believe that our Lord Jesus tells us in John chapter 15 that there are no branches in him that do not bear some kind of fruit, so I don't think it's an absolute wiping of the foundation clean. Every true believer will have that which is good to give to the Lord, but some obviously are going to have more than others. The wood, the hay, and the straw obviously refer to things that are worthless, to the things that we've done that have no value because they were not done for him. We were not seeking his glory in them, and what that could be a myriad of things, but it is time that is ultimately wasted, and we will not receive a reward for it. As a matter of fact, it may even create a measure of embarrassment, but again, we'll still be blameless before the Lord. We'll still have great joy. Now, the gold, silver, and precious stones refer to the things that we did do for him, to the sacrifices that we made for his glory and his kingdom, to the worship that we offered him as we gather together and also with our lives. It refers to the prayers that we have offered for his kingdom, to the service that we have rendered to others in his name, whether in the body of Christ or outside the body of Christ. It refers to our telling others about Jesus and doing what we can for their souls to lead them to salvation. And anything else that the Lord calls us to do for his glory, that's what this refers to. Now, what do you want Jesus to see when he looks at the building that you're building to stand before him on that day? What is it that you want to present to him? Now, the only things we're ever going to be able to take out of this world we've seen before are the things that we do for the Lord. I believe love for the Lord, the desire for his glory and honor, as well as, again, the rewards that we will receive by his grace on that day, dictate that we use our time wisely by investing our time in his kingdom. That's what it means to put the kingdom first. And doing this with all of our heart to the best of our ability is what it means to strive to enter the kingdom, to strive to advance the kingdom. But again, we do that by our use of time. So may the Lord then help us to make the most of the time that we do have remaining, to do what it is the Apostle Paul is telling us here, to redeem it, to buy it up, to use it to its best advantage. And we do that when we give it to him in his service, when we do what it is the Lord calls us to do. And in that sense, we can really do all that we do for his glory. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians, whatever you do, whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for his glory. We can honor him with all of our time, and that's what we ought to be seeking to do. So let's pray and let's ask the Lord to help us do exactly that, to take note of the fact that time is in short supply and is highly in demand, and therefore it's precious. And therefore, we should use it as best we can. Let's pray. I'll spend a few moments in silent prayer, and then I'll close us in prayer.